In the second and third quarters of 2021, Merger Market, on behalf of Dechert LLP, surveyed 100 senior-level executives within private equity firms based in North America for 45% of respondents, EMEA 35%, and Asia-Pacific 20%. In order to qualify for inclusion, the firms all needed to have $500 million or more in assets under management, and they couldn't be first-time funds. The survey included a combination of qualitative and quantitative questions. The results have been analyzed, collated, anonymized, aggregated, and presented in our 2022 Global Private Equity Outlook Study. So I'm delighted to be joined today by Markus Bolsinger, Siew Boon, and Chris Field. They're private equity partners at Dechert, along with private equity industry leaders Cyrus Driver, Managing Director at Partners Group based in Singapore, and Jérôme Nommé, Partner and Head of France at KKR, to both reveal the findings and discuss in greater detail market observations and outlooks. So, with those introductions, Chris, why don't you kick us off and set the stage for us, please?
Thanks, Tom. So the global private equity industry is absolutely flat out busy at the moment. I think the term we use in the report is scorching hot. And to put that into context, as you said, to set the stage, there was pent-up demand for deals, which was unleashed in the second half of 2020, following a brief hiatus when the COVID-19 pandemic sent economies all over the world into lockdown. But looking forward, as we head into 2022, there is little sign of this momentum letting up. In fact, it doesn't really matter on what front the industry's success is measured. The numbers just speak for themselves. I'm going to quote a few statistics now. There were 4,605 buyouts globally in the first three quarters of 2021. That already beats the annual record for global PE volume annually in any prior year. There was $1.17 trillion worth of deals that were recorded in those first three quarters, and that already eclipsed every prior full year stretching back to 2015. And if we look at that across geographies, in North America, total deal value over the first three quarters represented a 252% year-on-year gain. That's unbelievable. In the EMEA, it's been the busiest first three-quarter period in at least the last 5 years. And in Asia, full-on recovery from the lull that actually predated the pandemic. If we look at it from the fundraising perspective, $630 billion was raised by PE firms in the first 9 months of the year. If you extrapolate that run rate, the industry is expected to top prior records this year, surpassing $1.2 trillion. There was $666 billion worth of exits in the first three quarters. That's a level that has not been seen since records began. And finally, experts are saying that current private credit assets under management, which stand at over $1 trillion, and here's the interesting stat, Preqin estimates that will grow to $1.46 trillion, so an almost 50% increase in the next 4 years to 2025. So in summary, the PE industry is firing on all cylinders, and there are very few signs of that letting up.
Investor demand for private equity is at an all-time high, and money is pouring into fund managers' coffers. As Chris already called out, $630 billion in the first three quarters of 2021, setting a pace for a record-breaking year. All that dry powder, nearly 2 trillion, that is trillion with a T, is increasing demand for deals. Auctions are extremely competitive, paying top dollar, leaning on personal relationships, and preempt the auction whenever possible have become critical to success, have become critical success factors. Like in the APAC region, TMT and healthcare are the most active industry sectors in North America, trends that were further accelerated by the pandemic. The two sectors combined accounted for half of the North American deal value through the third quarter and also represents the majority of the activity in Dechert's private equity group. With that, back to you, Tom.
Great. Well, thanks, guys. So it's really been a record-breaking year overall, driven by that pent-up demand linked to COVID and pandemic that Chris alluded to. Let's talk about concentration. It's no secret that while private equity is seeing record sums of capital pouring into funds, assets under management aren't growing equally across the spectrum. So that trend was already playing out prior to 2020, but the pandemic has certainly exacerbated it. So in fact, the 50 largest private equity firms raised 50% of all capital in the industry, whereas first-time funds accounted for only 16% of closes in 2020. So I'd like to turn to Cyrus. Partners Group just recently closed its fourth PE buyout program with total commitments of $15 billion. That represents a great example of this trend, I think. So why do you think it was easier for Partners Group to raise such a substantial amount of capital at a time when new entrants are struggling?
Yes, Tom. So in one word, returns. So there was a recent Preqin study that compared returns since the financial crisis, so over the mini cycles we've had since then, for global private equity firms, and we were number two. But what underlies that, what makes the returns possible, are factors that require some scale. So private equity is mature to the point where returns are less driven by finding a small specialized business, somewhat less visible, to actually value creation post securing an investment. And in that, a global firm such as Partners Group has the benefit of resources spread around the world, global best practice that can be shared. We invest an inordinate amount of time in thematic research prior to an investment. We have a lot of resources that come into an investment with a transformation plan post-investing. All of that does require some scale. And that's why us and our peers, such as Jérôme's firm as well, are now pulling away, and scale is truly becoming a differentiator.
Great. Well, thanks for that, Cyrus. So let's turn to diversification. It's no surprise that many firms have diversified into broad-based alternative asset managers covering multiple investment strategies. And in fact, the alternative asset management industry has exploded into a $7 trillion US dollars industry overall. That's expected to reach $13 trillion by 2025. So spectacular growth overall. This trend has only accelerated in recent years, as confirmed by a survey this year, which found that 61% of respondents reported their interest in broadening their investment strategy has increased over the last 12 to 24 months. Let's turn to Jérôme now. While KKR began with leveraged buyouts raising $1 billion in the mid-80s, of course, it's achieved similar success since, diversifying into a global investment firm that manages multiple alternative asset classes, including private equity, credit, and real assets. In fact, I believe Dechert has worked with KKR in some of these efforts. What do you see as being the main reasons why firms like KKR are expanding into different asset classes?
Thank you, Tom. And thank you again for having me today. Really a pleasure to reflect on the year 2021, which was full of challenges and clearly very, very busy, as Chris said. I will echo what Cyrus said. Scale matters, and often scale goes hand in hand with diversification. It's another way of growing and of gaining scale. So Tom, you want to take us back to the 80s? Well, actually KKR started 45 years ago. And you know, at that time, none of us was around, or at least not working in PE. And you're right, it was only private equity at the time. And when you fast forward, and you look at KKR today, but also looking at the industry as a whole, the KKR today is indeed a diversified investment platform. Private equity is obviously a key strategy, but within private equity, you have various strategies. You have your traditional buyout, you have impact investing, you have your growth funds focusing on tech, on healthcare, our core fund, which is enabling us to hold companies for a much longer period. And beyond private equity, you're right, you have real estate with different strategies within real estate. You have infrastructure, you have credit. So quite a big evolution over 45 years. What I take away from this, on a daily basis on the ground, is that it changes really how we interact with our partners. Our partners are founders, management teams, corporates, family shareholders. It's not about pushing one product. This is about having a discussion on what your needs could be. And then you look at your toolbox, if I may say, and this ability to invest across the capital structure, you know, enables you to find, you know, to find the right solution. So yes, you need to be global, you need to be thematic, but this ability to understand how to invest across the capital structure is key. Earlier in the fall, a company named OVH, which is a leading European cloud provider, in which KKR had invested, was IPO'd on Euronext. Very successful IPO, the second largest in France this year in terms of retail demand. That was the largest retail demand in France for the last 10 years if you exclude privatization. We invested in OVH in 2016. We were able to do so successfully by combining private equity and credit teams and expertise. And very often you start with a discussion on PE and then it evolves and it becomes broader. Interestingly, it also enables us to have a broader dialogue with our LPs. So I was referring to our partners, alongside which we do invest, but you know, I should refer to our clients, our LPs, who are gonna trust us across a wider range of their capital allocation objectives across asset classes. This is also about innovation internally, because to grow those different strategies, you need people, you need entrepreneurship. So this is about the firm encouraging new ideas. You're giving platforms to newly hired or existing executives who want to build out a new business, which is obviously coherent with your overall strategy. So, you know, when COVID hit, we do believe that having those various strategies enabled us to be more agile. We've been fairly active in 2020. We actually invested three times more than average in PE. Maybe when all the firms, in contrast, stood back a little from investing. And I think having those strategies, made that possible. Lastly, in terms of key benefits, and I'm going back to Cyrus' point, in terms of scale, it enables you to mutualize your central resources. So think of your ESG team, your tech team, your macro team, your global institute, which at KKR is helping our portfolio companies or our investment committees with regard to public affairs and geopolitical matters. All of those functions and key resources can be used across asset classes. So, we're not saying that this is the only model that works, but I think the last 12 to 18 months have really tested this type of institution being able to be global, to be thematic, and to invest across asset classes. And I do believe this is a model that's going to continue and be very successful.
Well, thanks for taking us through that evolution, Jérôme. So a few bywords there. You mentioned investing across the capital structure. You talked about entrepreneurship and being agile. Let's hone in on one of those areas. So private credit, another asset class that's continuing to balloon. Today reached $1 trillion, is expected to grow by 46% by 2025. It's no wonder when almost half of our survey respondents say they've increased their use of private credit financing and buyouts over the last 3 years. That's a noticeable jump from our prior annual report when only 35% of respondents reported that. So Chris, in this year's survey, over half, 54% to be precise, of EMEA respondents said they now use private credit as their preferred choice over traditional bank financing in their buyouts. What do you see as the drivers of that trend? And are there any situations where you see traditional bank financing as being more appealing?
Yeah, Tom, that stat doesn't surprise me at all. But when we speak with our mid-market clients, two themes keep being repeated as to why they like to use private credit providers. And those are certainty and speed. In the current highly competitive market, sponsors want certainty that lenders can deliver on the terms that they need. And so lots of sponsors, and this has been an evolution, have developed close personal relationships with a core set of credit funds who they know can deliver the terms they need. So it's a case of known trust. And in that sort of an environment, the default becomes going to your favorite provider. And that's extremely helpful in the current environment of high valuations, because quite often private credit can provide an extra turn of leverage, which is a huge differentiator, obviously. And then talking about speed a little bit, speed of movement is absolutely critical in the current competitive environment. You know, if you know your trusted provider can offer a bespoke solution within the required timing, that gives you a competitive edge. A good example might be, say, you have a target which is going to have cash flow that's a bit tight initially, then you know that your provider, which you have this strong relationship with, will be a little bit more accommodating over that initial investment horizon. Or maybe you've got a target group that begins to get into financial difficulties. Again, you know they're going to be more accommodating. On the question you asked about how do the traditional banks still fit in to this world? So historically, on larger deals, you either needed to go to the public markets or look for a syndicated solution to get more advantageous terms. But increasingly, private credit providers are scaling up to billion-dollar plus deals. So I think that differentiator is beginning to disappear. I think the other situation where you would look to banks is if the target needs a meaningful revolver capacity. You know, there the banks can be helpful. In summary, those are my thoughts as to why we're seeing, and I think we'll continue to see, this increasing movement toward and use of private credit as a solution.
Well, thanks, Chris. Cyrus, I'd like to turn to you now. As a firm that has both a private equity and a credit arm, what do you see as being the main advantages to having both strategies under one firm? And can you give us a bit of color on how they're integrated within Partners Group, please?
Sure, Tom. So starting with the advantages, they're primarily there are two big advantages. One is a sector knowledge is shared. So knowledge of the competitive landscape, what the macro trends are, which firms are beneficiaries of those trends, which are not, which are well regarded by industry peers, which are not. All of the sector thematic work that we have large teams dedicated to, both lines of business benefit from that. The second big benefit is relationships. So our private credit business is focused on sponsor relationships. So it largely helps provide solutions to other sponsors for leverage buyouts. And in there, the width of our platform really helps. We have relationships with other sponsors as their LP. We provide secondary solutions for GPs. We sometimes buy businesses from them. We sometimes sell businesses to them. And our credit team is one of the most trusted partners as a financing provider. So for example, just this year in Asia, we sold one of our businesses, our largest sale to date, to another private equity firm we know well. It's a Pan-Asian GP. During the year, we've also provided credit for two of their buyouts. Our fund investment primaries team is an investor in their funds, and we provided secondary solutions to them over time as well. So that kind of wraparound relationship benefits all parts of our business. To the point about how integrated we are, I'd make one important distinction. We would never share information about a specific company or a target. So the very strict Chinese walls. I wouldn't even know which opportunities my colleagues on the credit side are working on. And we'd never share information on a target. So there's very strict separation of information specific to a target, definitely that under NDA. But a lot of sharing of broader industry knowledge, industry advisor relationships, and firm-level relationships.
Great. Well, thanks for that insight. Really interesting to hear how it's integrated within Partners. So thanks for that. Let's switch gears a little bit and turn to growth equity. So growth equity is becoming one of the fastest growing segments of the private equity market. As private equity companies raise larger amounts of capital and wait even longer to go public. In fact, 84% of our respondents from all regions globally reported their current funds invest in growth capital deals. 62% said they'd increased their interest over the past 2 years. Jérôme, so with growth equity becoming increasingly prevalent as an investment theme, we know some firms have gone as far as to create specific fund vehicles for these investments. KKR is one, of course, with its TMT growth fund and its healthcare strategic growth strategy in particular. Could you expand a little bit on your TMT and healthcare investment strategies on the growth side? What are the benefits of having this in place as part of a specialized growth equity fund?
Thank you, Tom. I was saying the world is changing, and you're going to tell me, yes, the world has been changing forever, but you know, we do feel there is an acceleration. The world is changing at an accelerated pace, and you have some sectors where companies go from early stage to later stage even faster. That is what we see. In tech, in healthcare, clearly seems to be the case. That is what we observe. And so, you know, in themselves, those are great areas of investment. I mean, early stage tech companies, early stage healthcare companies. But at the same time, it is very important for our later stage, more traditional, larger, funds to have that look into those early stage companies. So getting closer to those businesses, to invest in those businesses that are gonna grow, will also inform our thinking for our late stage, large scale deal making. Having said this, you need dedicated teams. Culturally is different. The way you do interact with the founder of a young, fast growing company, that is different. The way you analyze the investment case is different. So the challenge is really having those dedicated funds, strategies, and teams, but being very much integrated, it's information sharing so that we can also follow those companies. And sometimes we actually do invest in combination with a traditional buyout fund and with the early stage fund. So it applies very well to tech and healthcare, also because for those sectors, you need a very specialized knowledge. You cannot suddenly decide you're an expert in tech or you're an expert in healthcare. So you need the dedicated team. You are referring to KKR TMT growth equity strategy. We call it NGT. Just to give you some numbers, we're currently investing out of NGT2, which is a $2.2 billion. The previous fund, NGT1, was $700 million. So you see a material increase in terms of size, going back to your point that those strategies are gaining scale. That's 20 people globally, and that's 8 of those based in Europe. Our healthcare strategy growth fund, that's also the second fund, that's a $4.2 billion fund. The previous fund was 1.3. So here again, a material step up, and logically, the direction of travel should be the same going forward. And in healthcare growth, we have 32 people globally, of which six are in Europe. We can invest in through majority stakes, through minority stake in private companies. We can invest through minority stakes in public companies. So it's fairly flexible. What is different with a more traditional, larger buyout funds is smaller equity investments on average, more limited leverage, and very often we take a slightly higher execution risk. What's a side benefit as well for us is it's visible and it's relevant internally. As you know, there is a war for talent in our industry. It's about attracting, and it's true for Dechert, it's true for, I assume, for everyone in the industry. Having this type of strategies, these types of funds do help attracting talents. The ability to combine traditional buyout and growth funds looking at investment jointly is also a way to attract and motivate and retain talent.
Yeah, that's really interesting. How do you go about identifying the targets to invest in at that really early stage? How does that differ from the other parts of the firm?
Well, if I look at our next generation technology fund, the ecosystem is different. Those are not the same intermediaries. Often you don't have an intermediary. You know, the codes are different. And actually here in Paris, next to me, sits Lauriane. She's a member of the NGT team. So when we cover the French market, we share information, obviously, we compare notes, but a network with founders very often. You're dealing with founders when you look at early stage businesses. That is different. So you need to cultivate that network. You need to understand what's going to appeal to them. The ability to grow faster, the ability potentially to go to an IPO, maybe an IPO in the US. So you need to understand the expectations. So this is a different network. This is a different skill set. It's a different team, but it's sitting next to in the office next to mine. And you know, every day we compare notes. That's how it is.
Thanks for that insight. Really, really interesting on how you approach those early stage investments. So, Cam, let's turn to you now. I know that you've spent quite a bit of time in this segment of the market. Let's talk about the competitive environment. Are you finding it to be more competitive given the new mix of players overall?
Yeah, well, absolutely, I guess, to your two statements. But first, I want to kind of point out some of the things that Jérôme said. I think the dynamism that you talk about in this industry is truly exhilarating. In fact, Jérôme, I first came across KKR on the other side, and this is some years ago, on a Series D investment into a startup in Southeast Asia. You guys, I mean, that was early stage, and you guys were the first non-venture fund that invested into that company. It's now one of the biggest unicorns out of Southeast Asia, Gojek. So well done to you guys, to the agility you talked about before. But anyway, back to the question. So fueled by Gojek, Grab, and some of these other headline-grabbing successes, we in Asia now have a mix of a lot of interests from, as you say, a wide variety of players. But to add to that, we're also seeing interest from funds from abroad who are broadening their global mandate to invest out here. And they're exploring investments out here in a serious fashion, including from India, Middle East, the US, Europe, Japan, South Korea. So there's that level of competition because there are a lot of eyes. But in addition, there's also competition given the mix of players with varying interests. And these interests extend beyond just maximizing, the investment returns. They could include things like platform plays and other strategic plays. And that really does sway valuations and deal terms because these players actually value the deal differently. So it's a dynamic area. Back to you, Tom.
Yeah, thanks for that. It must have been a very busy year for you, obviously, with as you're saying, the headline-grabbing deals that have come out of Southeast Asia. Just to expand on that a little bit, I mean, what are you expecting in the next year or two? And what should we look out for after, Grab this year? What's next on the radar in terms of areas of the market that are really experiencing fast growth in Southeast Asia?
Yeah, it's a good question. So in Asia, we're actually right now working on a number of consolidations, roll-ups, and corporate restructurings in preparation of an exit. A lot of it through the capital markets. So I guess to your question, fingers crossed, maybe we should see more exits next year.
Fantastic. Let's turn to the next area, which is secondaries. So GP-led secondaries have been a major feature of both the European and the US markets over the last 18 months since the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic. The turbulence resulting from COVID-19 alongside an upsurge in equity values has led to an increase in GP-led secondaries. It's just another example of private equity coming up with creative solutions, I think, to the challenges it's faced, and in the process increases the volume of capital that's able to attract and invest in these sorts of deals. Cyrus, let's turn back to you. So Partners Group has established itself as a global secondary investor. You've provided liquidity to owners of private equity, private debt, private real estate, and private equity infrastructure portfolios. So what's your take on why GP-led secondaries are getting so much traction out there in the market?
Yes, Tom, and it's an growing phenomenon, not just in Europe and the US, but in Asia as well. And we feel it's here to stay. I think the macroeconomic experience of the last 2 years has much more strongly differentiated between quality, stable assets and those that are less so. So the premium that has gone up on winners in your portfolio for any investment firm, that premium has gone up a lot. And there are some firms and some sectors at the portfolio level that have shown a resilience to the last 2 years that makes owners want to stay in them and compound value for the long term. And this applies really typically to the best assets in a portfolio. And we see that trend increasing. So the last 2 years have been very positive for technology. For example, so if you have a technology business with recurring revenue, low churn, we're finding quite often the best assets in people's portfolio are going into a continuation fund, which is just a GP-led secondary. And we see that as a trend that's here to stay for a while. We participate in a lot of these. Just recently in Korea, for example, we were the anchor investor in a GP-led secondary that 90% of which is value was really from a star portfolio company for a Pan-Asian manager, a Korea-focused manager. So that's a trend we think will keep accelerating. Everyone we speak to and us ourselves are seeing the value of just compounding longer term in assets and management teams that you know well.
Great. Thanks for that, Cyrus. And Markus, what do you see as being the key advantages for secondary deals for both GPs and investors?
Yeah, thank you, Tom. I'm echoing what Cyrus said. And before we hit it, like just a little bit of stats, right? The market for secondhand stakes of private market assets is growing, as Cyrus said, rapidly, and is expected to hit $100 billion by the end of 2021. So it started relatively small in the early 2000s. It's now a $100 billion asset. And I think that's another sign of the maturation that both Jérôme and Cyrus spoke about on the alternative investment asset marketplace, where, as I describe it, it's like every slice of every piece of the private equity transactor market is actually carved out and creates its own little market. And then investment funds behind it who back that market, and the secondary hand stakes is another one of that. So the driver behind the secondary market, other than the continuation where you want to hold it for longer, is on the LP side, they're looking for yield. This is a nice way of finding yield because the secondary transaction are a attractive entry for new LPs into an existing portfolio that they can fully diligence, right? It's not a blind pool that you invest in from the front end, but it's already a portfolio that you can, right? Sometimes you make commitments for additional investments, but a lot of the assets are already there that you can diligence when you make the investment. So it's lower risk. That probably comes away along with a lower overall return expectation, but there's a lot less risk than investing in a blind fund. And to the GPs, in addition to really liking your asset and holding on, I think the other side of the secondary transaction is where a portfolio is not yet ripe because maybe it was not one of the winners in coming out of the pandemic and you don't feel it's ready to be harvested and you need further nurturing and possibly additional investments to get to that exit. And because you have already been in there for a reasonably long time, some of your LPs are looking for an exit and a liquidity event. And rather than just letting your LPs trade their stakes on the other secondary market where the GP is not in control, this is actually one where the GP takes control, auctions off, and trying to find a large buyer of what often is a majority in the fund to continue and get new investments. I think that's attractive to the GP. And obviously it's helpful if to the extent there is a reset or reload of the incentive compensation going on for the GPs. Back to you.
Well, thanks Markus for going through that. Let's talk about another strategy. Everyone's favorite topic this year is SPACs. So despite 2/3 of survey participants either currently employing a SPAC or planning to do so, SEC scrutiny and a wave of lawsuits underway may lead to a slowdown in new issuances, particularly in North America, given the SEC chairman's speech last week, which hinted that reforms may be coming around SPAC disclosure rules. I think everyone's heard a lot about North America. Let's focus on Asia a little bit. So, Siew, in stark contrast to North America, SPAC mergers are really just beginning to take hold as a viable exit option in the APAC region, with listings traditionally being so difficult. How frequently are your private equity clients considering SPACs when considering their portfolio companies' exit strategies? And are you aware of any Asia-based private equity firms that are forming their own SPAC vehicles?
Great question. I think it's a mixed bag. I would say, I mean, my clients frequently look into all exit options anyway. And so they tell me they will explore SPACs too. Bankers are often engaged to look at SPACs as a third track or an alternative track to an IPO. But I would caveat all that to say that's only for very sizable assets. So in Southeast Asia, this option has not traditionally featured itself so frequently because we've not had too many assets of that size here. Having said that, number one, we just had the largest ever SPAC merger that closed earlier this month. That was Grab, which is a ride-hailing group in Southeast Asia. And two, the SPAC trend in Southeast Asia does go through its ebbs and flows, just like the US. And actually, in the last few months, my clients who, you know, explored SPACs early in the year have shifted towards exploring traditional IPOs instead. So to your other question, Tom, yes, there's been a number of Asian PE funds that's listed their SPAC vehicles in the US, Primavera, Citic Capital, Everstone, Vickers, but I'm not aware any has actually de-specced yet. Singapore has actually also recently allowed SPAC listings on its stock exchange, and a number of Southeast Asian PE funds are exploring it. Novatellus, Tikehau, Vertex, VinaCap, Vickers. I guess in doing so, the SGX is actually hoping to get more or attract more ASEAN unicorns to list on its stock exchange. And from speaking to my clients, I think there's a general consensus that the SGX, Singapore Stock Exchange, and the monetary authority is working hard towards creating regulations that achieves a good balance between sponsors, spec targets, and investor interests. And that's important to, you know, attract SPAC listings. The other thing is that SPAC listings here at between the $100 to $200 million range would mean or could mean that there could be a larger range of strong targets who are looking to exit, but which are too small for US SPACs. So we could theoretically see more of, you know, those deals too. We could also theoretically see some of the natural flow of SPAC deals with Chinese targets, particularly given the US-China situation. So I think to sum up, hopefully these could also lead to more SPAC activities out here next year.
So it could be interesting to watch. Let's talk about ESG. So ESG has had what I describe as a meteoric rise up the corporate agenda, and that's set to continue. Regulations now in force in Europe, and the US is likely to follow suit. It's not only European firms that must comply, but also any managers that actively manage their funds in the EU. So let's turn to Jérôme on this. What are the key ESG considerations to take into account in this investment strategy?
ESG is a vast and an important topic. Yes, we talk a lot about it. It is not new. I mean, at least at KKR, it's not new at all. Maybe we talk more about it. Maybe you're right. It's more on the corporate agenda. But very factually, at KKR, we've been a signatory to the UNPRI, which is United Nations Principles for Responsible Investing, since 2009. And since 2011, KKR has been producing an annual ESG report describing, you know, everything we do in terms of responsible investment. So it is obviously over time more and more structured, you have more and more resources, but this is not new. And 12 years ago, KKR started building a team. Now, what's interesting to see is that on this, Europe. And here in Europe, ESG is something which is at the core of our investment decision making process. It's at the core of portfolio management, and actually ESG now is managed like any other business issue. That's how we need to look at it. It's not just a matter of ticking the box. It's not a matter of ESG risks. It's also a matter of value creation opportunities through ESG. So in that regard, the mindset of the industry, and it started a long time ago at KKR, has evolved. And it means building up the structure behind it. You need the team, you need the experts, you need the network of advisors. In your IC process, it needs to be designed to help your teams to structure their thinking, the analytical approach to the material ESG dimensions for their deals. And again, for that, they need support in terms of portfolio management. At KKR, we have Capstone with a group of 80 people focusing on helping our portfolio companies with regard to operational performance. They will also help guide the management teams with regard to translating the ESG dimension into something concrete. It needs to be concrete. So it means having KPIs. If you cannot measure, you cannot manage. And that applies very much so to ESG. So you need to have a clear set of KPIs. You're going to measure progress, baseline, tracking, and you're going to make a link with compensation, because that's how it works. So it's becoming something very structured, completely embedded in everything we do. And this is not something you do in isolation and you define your own KPIs. You also need to work with third parties. I was referring to the UNPRI. Obviously we should refer to the EU SFDR, which is the Sustainable Finance Disclosure Regulation. Those are disclosure benchmarks not set by KKR, but set by the EU. And if you take KKR here in Europe, we are committing to Article 8, compliant from an SFDR standpoint in our European private equity strategy. So you need to do it. You need to follow those KPIs. You need to track them, and you can even go beyond. For instance, we will also require all companies where we have a controlling position to implement decarbonization plans within 2 years of our investment, consistent with the sector in which the specific company operates, in line with the ambition to reach the net zero carbon emission by 2050. So this is clearly on the agenda, embedded in every single decision-making process. And then, when we report to the deal team, when we report to our portfolio management committee, when we report to management teams, we track progress. So, there is no turning back. It's on the top of the agenda. It will remain on the top of the agenda. And when you take a step back, and I'm going back to motivating the teams, this is a mindset change. And I think the new generation is pushing us on this, very much so. And in PE, we have also a young population. When you pushing the agenda with regard to ESG, when you are active in terms of impact investing, that resonates very strongly internally as well. KKR has so far already invested more than $7 billion across companies that offer solutions contributing to sustainability, from climate change to green energy, from responsible waste management to clean water protection. So, behind the KPIs, there is also now, within the PE industry and more broadly, the investment industry, I think a conviction that we can be part of the solution. It is not just about we have to do it. It is not just, like ESG, an ESG dimension. This is very concrete. We have an impact next to the management teams, next to our portfolio companies. when we do invest in a company called CNC Machinery, that is a provider of innovative, sustainable packaging serving Amazon, well, basically, we reduce the use of packaging. That's it. And if we help that company grow, we contribute. And you know, we have numerous examples in that category. So, you know, I could go on and on and on, but ESG, that is not just three letters. It's very concrete. It's processes, KPIs, it's tracking over time, but it's also, you know, making an impact and very concretely contributing to finding a solution to the sustainability challenges that we all face.
Fantastic, and really interesting to hear the structured, embedded approach as you're describing it there. Cyrus, it is of course fashionable to talk about ESG and impact, but it's sometimes hard to know whether a firm is really making progress. So really great to see how KKR doing that. How does a partners group provide transparency to all stakeholders on its ESG agenda?
Very good question, Tom. Similar to what Jérôme was saying, ESG has been a very high priority for us for a long time and is only becoming more so. So, you know, one of the founding pillars of our purpose as a firm has been to create lasting positive impact. That's what our investors want. That's what employees get motivated by. That's what potential management teams you can work with get inspired by. We embed an ESG initiative into every new investment in the value creation plan. It's part of the directions and goals for the company. It's something the board of that portfolio company will review periodically. And then we create transparency by measuring and sharing with every stakeholder how those ESG initiatives are going. So each portfolio company has an ESG KPI dashboard. We then summarize that in a sustainability report that we issue together with our annual report as a firm. So in this year's sustainability report, for example, while there were multiple initiatives, there was an additional emphasis this year on two things: climate change strategy as one key pillar and diversity and inclusion as the second. On the climate change strategy, you know, as an example, KinderCare, a childcare business in the US, the largest childcare business in the US, had delivered energy savings of up to 60% across its centers. Across the portfolio, we had reduced electricity consumption by 55 gigawatt hours, and we had avoided 1.5 million metric tons of carbon dioxide emissions. So these KPIs would get aggregated up across the portfolio, reported by company and for the portfolio overall. On diversity and inclusion, a topic that's harder to measure often, one of our portfolio companies in the UK, Civica, was ranked 73rd out of 15,000 companies in Europe in the Financial Times list as inclusive employers. As the KPI we measured, portfolio-wide, the percent of female management in CEO minus one, so in the C-suite, moved from 20% in 2018 to 26% in 2020. Now, that's clearly not enough progress, but it's moving in the right direction. And measuring it just holds ourselves accountable to a much larger audience.
Great. Well, thanks for that, Cyrus. We've got a couple more areas to get through. Let's turn to creative deal structuring. So GPs are having to think more creatively in order to put record sums of dry powder, which we talked about, to work. Recent activities also see the return of mega club deals. They can help all parties leverage knowledge and the expertise of all involved. An example of this is when Bain Capital and Hellman and Friedman joined forces to buy Athena Health for $17 billion. That was a deal in which Dechert advised GIC as a co-investor. So pooling capital in this way can also help GPs give GPs more flexibility and options in a fiercely competitive market. Chris, let's turn to you. 53% of our survey respondents in North America anticipate that the prevalence of club deals will increase in the wake of the pandemic, as compared to 37% in EMEA and 30% in APAC. So what's your take on whether that trend has staying power?
Tom, so my take, the short answer is yes. I think it absolutely has staying power. As long as the current benign highly accommodative market conditions continue. We've talked already about the amount of dry powder that's available. And what that means is sponsors are looking at larger and larger deals. And there's a real advantage with that size of deal to be able to share the risk among sponsors. And it also allows you to get the deal away quicker and with more certainty. I think there's also an element of momentum. Once you've done a successful club deal with a particular sponsor, it's more likely that you will do other deals with the same sponsor again. It's a kind of, you know that it works momentum. And so increasingly, we're seeing the same groupings of capital providers working together. And that's whether it's by way of a co-investment or on a club deal.
Thanks, Chris. And what about structured equity, Markus? What do you think makes those types of investments so attractive in this environment?
They are, you know, to borrow a term from my friend Chris, funky investments in that they do not fit the traditional molds of like venture capital, LBO, mezzanine. And they tend to be minority non-controlled investments with a more profitable return characteristic than mezzanine investments, but less profitable than pure play control PE investments. And I think Jérôme, when he was talking about the diversification, put actually his finger on the point, right? It's like, you want to talk to your partners how you can help them across all of the capital structure. And the structured equity was like the last piece where it didn't fit in any of the pre-existing categories. So you come up with something that's highly bespoke to fit the existing capital structures and existing portfolio company. And you come in and figure out how to deploy capital that works for you, obviously, as the investor, but also for all of the other stakeholders. I think it's another, and that now big funds like KKR and Partners Group have like actual dedicated investment strategy and raising funds around it tells you that like that's, it is attractive because it sits between the high return expectations, higher risk PE, but above, so below that, but above the mezzanine kind of lower return, lower risk, you have to fit something in there. And the reason why Chris and I and Sukem like these, they're intellectually challenging because you need to work with the existing capital structure. You need to figure out how to make it work for all of them. And right, there's more focus on, because they're highly bespoke and it's not just a growth investment where everyone is focused on the upside, you do need to protect against the downside. So you have to put all around, get all around that, right? Sometimes they're called special situation funds, special opportunity funds, dislocation funds, tactical opportunity funds. So you're either focused on the company needs money, but it's not coming from the existing providers, or you're in a distressed situation where the existing capital structure, the existing investors are not willing to put more money in. So there's an even larger focus on protecting the downside. All of that, I think, is bespoke, which makes it fun. And if it works out, the return for the investor is great. So I think that's why it's attractive to all the participants.
Great. Thank you very much. Well, let's talk quickly about some of the key sectors. We've talked a lot about tech and healthcare, and really those have been the two sectors have really been under the radar, so to speak. On the tech side, the pandemic's accelerated digital consumer habits and increased dependency on fiber networks and infrastructure. No surprise that TMT's outperformed sectors across the world. And with healthcare, the pandemic has created unprecedented demand for medicines and healthcare services, making another dominant sector for PE investing. Cyrus, perhaps we'll stay with you. Which subsectors within TMT do you see as seeing the most interest and why?
Yes, and that's actually a hard question to answer because there's growth in multiple sectors, Tom. The way we've mapped out our plan, we start with two giga themes that we believe are multi-year themes. Digitization and automation across industries is one big giga theme, and the second is new living by consumers. On the digitization and automation front, some of the sub-themes where we have actionable targets and have made investments are SMB digitization, CFO technology, outsourced digital engineering services, robotic process automation. And one example amongst these is Global Logic, a business we exited this year that's one of the global leaders in outsourced digital engineering. It helps non-tech businesses digitalize and create their consumer front end. It was a very strong exit for us, almost $10 billion in value at exit. The second big yoga theme of new living translates to us for a focus into fintech and digital marketing and IoT. And just in the last 12 months, we've made investments in Nubank, a digital bank in Latin America, in VFox, a digital insurance play in Europe, both of which are growing strongly. And there's then many other subsegments within technology. I think the challenge with technology from a thematic top-down really is a problem of plenty. And we recognize that there are many investors looking at technology, so we prefer to pick our battles, go deep on a few subsegments, and then spend, you know, literally years in those working with the most promising players.
Great. Thank you, Cyrus. Jérôme, what about on the healthcare side?
First of all, I will completely echo what Cyrus said. Technology is, for KKR as well, a priority sector. But it also cuts across all of the other industries. Digitization, for instance, that applies to every industry. So it's interesting to see when we look at new investment opportunities at the IC, there is always the ESG component that we discussed. There is always a technology component, regardless of whether or not it's a technology investment per se. Healthcare, we're going to make the link because healthcare also needs to accelerate its digitization in many of its subsegments. But you're right, it's been a very interesting time to invest in the healthcare sector for an obvious reason. The crisis has reminded all of us how critical the healthcare sector is. I'm just stating the obvious. And this goes from healthcare services, hospitals, to pharma companies coming up with vaccines, including the diagnostics and labs sector. So clearly casting a light, if needed, on that very strategic sector. At KKR, we've been investing in the sector for a long time. If you look at the last 20 years, that's $11 billion invested in the space. And we do like this because of the investment opportunities themselves, obviously, but also because then you do invest in companies that have a purpose. So you combine those two benefits. You need to look beyond the short-term winners. We do believe that the pandemic will have long-lasting impact. I'm going back to digitization, making the link with what we were discussing earlier. Hospitals, in terms of protecting data, a number of hospitals have been the target of cyber attacks. So you need to up your game in terms of cybersecurity, in terms of patient pathway, in terms of patient education around health and wellness. Hospitals are evolving. We've invested in Elsan, which is the largest chain of private hospitals in France. It's very good in terms of quality, excellent management team. In terms of digitization, there's still a lot to do. And this is where we can help. Going back to what we were discussing with regard to healthcare growth, our investment vehicle, our strategy to invest into earlier stage companies, that's key. This industry is evolving, faster and faster. The ability to invest in companies like Gamma Biosciences earlier this year in Europe, which is a platform operating a portfolio of investments in the life sciences tool sector. Those are key segments growing very fast that can benefit from partnering from firms like KKR. But again, the punchline is, it's not just about COVID casting a light on healthcare. This is about, you know, long-lasting trends that will make this this space very much investable in our view.
Well, thank you, Jérôme, for that insight on the healthcare side. Let's now turn to closing remarks and what you expect to be the key themes in 2022. What are the main areas that you're expecting to be particularly dominant next year? Cyrus, why don't you start us off?
Sure. So my outlook for 2022, at the risk of this being famous last words, we finally get past the pandemic to some kind of new normal. We have moderate growth, moderately high inflation. Digitalization continues apace, so technology remains a very vibrant sector. And we face multiple policy risks from Fed tapering to geopolitical strains between the US and China.
Jérôme?
To be frank, I do believe 2022 is still going to be a very exciting and eventful year. There will be headwinds. We don't know which ones. Is that inflation? Is that shortage of materials? Is that new aspirations from a part of the workforce? What I do believe is that we're coming out even stronger than we were 2 years ago. I think our industry has proven its adaptability and resilience. And in that regard, I'm very positive and I'm very, very optimistic with regard to 2022, even though it's going to be, again, a year, which is going to be full of challenges. And if when I take a step back, investors are looking for opportunities with significant growth potential, and private equity remains very attractive in that regard. European PE has outperformed public markets, and I see no reason for this not to continue in 2022.
Thank you. See you, Cam.
I'm going to repeat up all the wonderful things my friends have said. So I'm going to talk about my hope for next year. My hope will be that there'll be more focus on ESG considerations in Asian deals next year, much like what Jérôme and Cyrus discussed earlier.
Chris.
I thought I was going to be the contrarian, but actually I'm going to wind up echoing what others have said. If I look out under the horizon coming into 2022, it looks pretty spectacular for the private equity industry, but I can also see a few small clouds out there on the horizon that we need to watch. Thinking about the COVID-19 pandemic's ongoing effects and potentially resultant supply chain disruptions. How does that all evolve? And perhaps more fundamentally, which I know others have touched on, is there a degree of permanence or even potentially an acceleration to the emergent inflationary trends that we're seeing? So as a lawyer, I think it's only right I sound that note of caution.
Thanks, Chris. Markus, what do you think?
I'll be less lawyerly and share people's overall optimism for the PE industry. And listening to what Cyrus and Jérôme are talking about, I think echo is what I'm a firm believer of, is that the private equity governance model is the far superior governance model over any other governance model. McKinsey recently published its playbook for newly minted private equity portfolio companies because of the record number of deals that PEs have been doing. And I think that brought it to a point. The PE professionals serving on the board of a portfolio company not only have fiduciary duties to that portfolio company and show up at the quarterly meetings, but it's their day job to supervise that company. And for all of those reasons, together with Partners Group and KKR have done it for over a decade, but if the industry's expanded focus on ESG by the private equity sponsor, I think the superior governance model will only get better. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, everyone, for those remarks. Well, on that note, we've run out of time. I'd like to thank all of our speakers today for a really fascinating, insightful discussion. It's been a tour of the private equity landscape and what to expect in 2022, from diversification, growth strategies, SPACs, ESG, sector trends. And I found it really insightful. So thank you to everyone, and thank you to everyone for listening today. I'd like to wish everyone a happy holidays and a fantastic 2022. Thank you very much.